drawer in the big.
Okay, because I'm like tied to not being able to move.
Here we go, guys. You ready? Hey, good morning, church.
Would you stand with me if you're able? Let's worship the Lord this morning. It's a beautiful Sunday. It's the first Sunday in Advent. Favorite time of year.
Come all you weary, come all you thirsty, come to the well that never runs dry. Drink of the water, come and thirst no more. Come all you sinners, come find his mercy. Come to the table, he will satisfy. Taste of his goodness, find what you're looking for. For God so loved the world that he gave us, his one and only Son to save us. Whoever believes in him will live forever. Is waiting there with open arms. Yeah, he has open arms. For God so loved the world that he gave us, his one and only Son to save us. Whoever believes in him will live forever. God so loved the world.
Praise him. Praise God. Praise God. From whom all blessings flow. Praise him. Praise him. For the wonders of his love.
Let's sing it out. Come on.
Praise God.
God some praise this morning, church. Amen. Go ahead and grab a seat. If I haven't had a chance to meet you yet, my name's Conan. I'm the Creative Arts Student Ministry Director here at Victory Lutheran Church. It is such an honor to be here with you today. Would you turn your attentions to the side screens for this morning's announcements?
Going to be having a salad and sandwich potluck on your church. On December 31st, we'll have one service at 9:30. Don't forget, you can also give online at findvictory.org or on our church app. And if you're new here, we would love to get to know you. If you could fill out a connection card and sit on the coffee bar, it would be great. That way we can get to know you more. Thank you guys for coming. Hope you have a great Sunday, and we'll see you next week.
You know, December is jam-packed, full of fun things. I think, do we have clipboards? Did we forget to do that in the last service for the community Christmas dinner? I think we got it, right? We're feeling good? Oh, they're on the pulpit? Okay. Well, we do have clipboards for the community Christmas dinner. If you haven't signed up and you're looking for an opportunity to be blessed while blessing others, we're going to be passing these around. And if you decide, even after the fact, like, hey, maybe I want to just...
Can I tell you what I was thinking?
Yeah, go ahead.
If you're a member here, you worship here, and you're coming to this event, guess what? Work. We need you to set up, serve, and clean up. One of those three. Amen? Can you just say amen?
Amen.
So can we do away with the clipboards? I mean, you get that, right?
Amen.
What do you need, Faye?
What?
Underneath all that? Christmas dinner. Oh, there's Christmas dinner stuff too. So, yes, well, that one's a little more intense. So if you would just take a look at the Christmas dinner stuff, that would be good. But for the sandwich and potluck, just come. You're going to work. Amen?
Amen.
All right, good.
Kids are working real hard on that program
makes
too.
It
it's going to be awesome. So we'd love to see a good showing for those kids. We're going to go right into our call to worship, which comes from Psalm 95, verses 1 through 3. Come, let us sing for joy to the Lord. Let us shout aloud to the rock of our salvation. Let us come before him with thanksgiving and extol him with music and song. For the Lord is the great God, the great King above all gods. Would you stand with me if you're able as we continue to worship and sing unto the Lord this morning?
Our God is greater.
Starting to come. There we go. This morning I'm going to share a scripture reading that is found in Romans chapter 1. If you have your Bibles along with you, or you can follow along on the screen. Reading from the Word of the Lord. For since the creation of the world, God's invisible qualities, his eternal power and divine nature have been clearly seen, being understood from what has been made, so that that men are without excuse. For although they knew God, they neither glorified him as God nor gave thanks to him. But their thinking became futile and their foolish hearts were darkened. Although they claimed to be wise, they became fools and exchanged the glory of the immortal God for images made to look like mortal man and birds and animals and reptiles. Therefore, God gave them over in the sinful desires of their hearts to sexual impurity for the degrading of their bodies with one another. They exchanged the truth of God for a lie and worshipped and served created things rather than the Creator, who is forever praised. Amen. Because of this, God gave them over to shameful lusts. Even their women exchanged natural relations for unnatural ones. In the same way, the men also abandoned natural relations with women and were inflamed with lust for one another. Men committed indecent acts with other men and received in themselves the due penalty for their perversion. Furthermore, since they did not think it worthwhile to retain the knowledge of God, he gave them over to a depraved mind to do what ought not to be done. They have become filled with every kind of wickedness, evil, greed, and depravity. They are full of envy, murder, strife, deceit, and malice. They are gossips, slanderers, God-haters, insolent, arrogant, and boastful. They invent ways of doing evil. They disobey their parents. They are senseless, faithless, heartless, ruthless. Although they know God's righteous decree that those who do such things deserve death, they not only continue to do these very things, but also approve of those who practice them. Anybody can stand here this morning and say that they are unscathed by that scripture? Probably would all agree that there's something up there that could speak to our heart and convict us of sin against a holy God, couldn't we? Right? As we cry out to God, we are lifting up our voices, we're praising him for who he is, what he has done, but we're also invited to come before a holy and righteous God that is able to forgive us of those very things of which he convicts us of this morning. So this time in our service, and when we do our corporate call to our corporate confession together that we see in this service at communion, but we say, Lord, forgive me for the things that I have done and the things that I have not done. Not worshiped you, not held your word, and not looked to you and held your word and your righteous decrees above these things. Right? that in and of itself is sin. And so this morning we come before God as children of God, as holy and righteous and forgiven, but yet we still need to call out our need and repent of the things that are not of the Lord in our lives, don't we? And so at this time I invite you, as God is laying on your heart, to confess those sins before our holy and righteous God, who is faithful and just and will forgive us of those sins. But would you go before the Lord this morning, and if he's laying something on your heart, would you take that before him this morning? Would you trust him and lay that down at his feet? Take a couple moments as we confess privately before our Lord this morning. Invite us to gather as your church, as your body, as your family, and we come before you and we lift up our voices and sing praises to you. But Lord, as we hear your word, as we've heard this word from Romans 1 this morning, we come before you and we fall flat on our faces, knowing that we are inadequate, knowing that we daily sin, that we go against your will for us. And Lord, we come to you this morning, we confess those sins before. And Lord, we thank you for your righteousness, for your mercy, for the grace, the free gift that has been given to us in your Son, Jesus Christ, and that we can stand here before you and know that you have taken these, that they were nailed to the cross with our Lord and Savior, and that we can be resurrected with him in new life. And so we thank you for this work, this grace, this mercy that has been given to each and every one who have confessed in true faith here before you this morning. And church, it is my honor and privilege as a pastor to stand before you and say that the Lord is faithful and just. As you have confessed in true faith, your sins are forgiven. Go and sin no more. Now, would you stand with me and with Conan and the worship team as we praise this Almighty God who cleanses us and forgives us?
Thank you.
soul. The price it has been paid. For Jesus bled and suffered for my pardon. And he was raised to overthrow the grave. To this I hope, my sin has been defeated. Jesus now and ever is my way. Oh, the chains are released. I can sing, I am free. And not I, but through Christ in me. Follow Jesus, for he has said that he will bring me home. And day by day, I know he will renew me until I stand with surety for the throne. To this I hold, my hope is only Jesus. Oh, my glory evermore to him. When the race is complete, still my lips shall he be. Yet not I, but through Christ in me. To this I hold, to this I hold. My hope is only Jesus. All the glory evermore to him. When the race is complete, still my lips shall he be. Yet not I, but through Christ in me. When the race is complete, still my lips shall he be. Yet not I, but through Christ in me. Christ in me, yet not I, but through Christ in me. We believe. Unexpected, would you believe? After all we project, a child in the manger, lowly and small, the weakest of all, unlikeliest here, wrapped in his mother's shawl, just a child. Is this who we've waited for? 'Cause how many step down from their thrones. How many lords have abandoned their homes? How many graves have become the least for me? And how many gods have poured out their hearts to romance a world that is torn all apart? torn all apart. How many fathers gave up their sons for me? Only one did that for me.
As we're coming into the Advent season, isn't it great how thankfulness and hopefulness and expectation kind of all intertwine this time of year? As we look at we just sang about the King who gave up everything to come and pursue us and to bring holiness and righteousness and salvation and restoration for us. As we look towards this Advent season, as we celebrate Christmas, as we look back at Thanksgiving, as we are grateful and thankful for everything, but in all of this, we see this gift of faith and righteousness and holiness that is brought to us this time of year, that is within us, that allows us to confess, and man, that is a worthy God, isn't he? As we get to worship and cry out and gather in service to him. We're also invited, as we look at everything as gift, to give of the gifts that we have received. And this time of our service, we want to invite just that, as we are called as the church to give to the mission and the work of the Lord continues to do. And we have a few different ways that we want to invite you to engage with that. If you have a bulletin or the Church Center app or even the church website, you can click on that QR code, open up your camera and follow that link. You can give through the church website, but we also have a basket in the narthex that we would invite you to give of gifts back there if you'd like to do it the old analog way as well. So we understand that too. But this is what God calls us to as his church. If you're here visiting, man, we are so grateful that you are here. I hope that you can connect with Pastor Sean, myself, or Conan here this morning. We would love to get to know you, invite you out for coffee or a meal, ask questions about how you can plug into the church. But if you're here and you're visiting, we want to invite you to just take this in. This is what God calls us to do as his family, and we hope that maybe God would invite you into that family. You'd find a place home to call home here at Victory. And as the Lord leads, we would invite you to give at that time. But we're here to participate today. But would you pray with me as we bless this morning's offering? Heavenly Father, we come before you this morning, and it is just the constant reminder before us, the ever-present reminder of what it is that you have done through your Son, Jesus Christ, that was sent to Calvary to be nailed upon the cross, to be crucified, dead and buried, but yet he rose again from the dead and is living and is seated at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. And Lord, we praise you as we come into this Christmas season, as we have the reminder of Advent, the preparation of our hearts to receive the King that has already come. But Lord, as we think of the gifts that you've done and the work that you've done in our lives, Lord, we bring our offerings before you this morning. And we ask that you would bless these, that these would come from joyful and grateful hearts. God, that you would continue to bless us, whether with much or with little. But we praise you and we trust you for what you have done. And we give you these gifts this morning, and we ask that you would bless them, that you would multiply them for your glory and for your kingdom, the work that you are doing here at Victory Inn in Jamestown. And we give you all the glory and praise in your name, we pray. Amen. So I want to invite you at this time, if you have offerings that you would like to place in the basket, you can do that so at this time, but I want to invite you to stand with me this morning as we greet our neighbors, as we pass the peace. It is cold and flu season, so use your discretion. If you need to wave, if you need to give an elbow or a fist bump to keep those germs to yourself, we appreciate it. But we want to go around and greet one another. If you see somebody you haven't met, make sure to meet them first. So,
praise God. Can everyone say praise God? The Lord is in the house. Jesus is here and he's working. He's speaking to our hearts as we've been singing and praying and hearing his word read today. And now God wants to do open heart surgery with every one of us. He wants to speak intimately into our lives. He wants to make some significant shifts in how we perceive and receive and walk in that which he's doing. Every time you come under the hearing of God's word, you should expect God to be doing something amazing. And you know, God not only does it with the adults, but God does it with the children. And God raises up great children's leaders like Kendra. Yeah, what time is it, Kendra? King's kids are dismissed pre-K to second grade. You are dismissed right now. Be released. King's kids, have fun. Have a good time. Pray that you're blessed as you go and do your thing. If you remember a few weeks ago, I said that we were going to bookend Thanksgiving. Last weekend, can you wrap your mind around this? Last weekend was Thanksgiving weekend. That feels like 8 months ago. I mean, Black Friday hits. We get into the Christmas rush. My daughter wants the Christmas tree up. My wife's talking about, well, we got Joel List. We got Levi. We got to get out. What do you think about this for Ethan? And so we've got all of the Christmas bustle going on right now. You got it going on in your life. I have it going on in my life. And Thanksgiving is but a distant memory. It feels gone. But we're bookending Thanksgiving. We're bookending gratitude this week. 2 weeks ago we started out. Last week we're gonna bring it to a close, and then we're gonna launch into a 5-week sermon series on the gift of Christmas. What's that gift? What does the meaning of that gift do for us? Today we're gonna take a look at Luke chapter 17, 11 through 19. I'm gonna read our gospel text today in Jesus Christ. In the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Now on his way to Jerusalem, Jesus traveled along the borders between Samaria and Galilee. Take note of that. As he was going into the village, 10 men who had leprosy met him. They stood at a distance. He called out in a loud voice, "Jesus, Master, have pity on us." They all called out, crying out to the Lord. When he saw them, he said, "Go, show yourself to the priest." And as they went, they were cleansed. One of them, when he saw he was healed, came back praising God in a loud voice. He threw himself at Jesus' feet and thanked him, and he was a Samaritan. Jesus asked, "Were not all 10 cleansed? Where are the other 9? Was no one found to return to give praise to God except this foreigner?" Then he said to him, "Rise and go. Your faith," say it with me, "your faith has made you well." Today, as we wrap up this sermon series on gratitude, I want us to ask ourselves a significant question before we dive into this text. And the question is, as you are going through life, some of you are grandpas and grandmas, some of you are parents, some of you are just getting started, you're really just getting married. You're going to be getting married. I mean, the question just was popped in the last 6 months. You're planning a wedding. You're thinking about your future. You're thinking about how many kids are we going to have, you know, and where should we buy a house, and what kind of a career are we going to have, or I'm going to stick with this career and hope I can work my way up in this. I mean, you got all those plans going on. The kids, you high school and college boys that are here, you're thinking about what kind of a career should I do. The parents that have been married for a few years, like Mrs. Bowman and myself, we are thinking, oh, God, let our kids make it, all 5 of them. And for some of you, 6, for some of you, 2 or 3, whatever it is, we are praying. But one thing we all know for sure is that life has its troubles. Life has its struggles. Life has its ways of sending twists and turns to us. And here in our text, as we start peeling apart this text, I want you to hear about how God breaks in to some folks' lives that have zero hope. Zero hope. And the same God who touched these lepers' lives is the same God who's here that wants to set you free. And maybe you're struggling. Maybe you're struggling with your marriage. Maybe you're struggling with your work, your boss, your colleagues, your siblings. Maybe you're struggling with your husband, your wife, your kids, your adult kids. Maybe you're struggling because you've gotten some bad news. Whatever it is that you're struggling with right now, today, that you have a burden. I want you to hear God working through this text today for 9 people who are hopeless and helpless, and see how the hand, the healing hand of God, was active, moving for those who had ears to hear and for those who could respond to the work of God. Now, in our text, we see that this gospel lesson in Luke brings the account of 10 lepers. You've all read it before if you've read the Bible at all. And Jesus is dealing with these 10 lepers. One faithful man returns and gives thanks to God, and Jesus says, your faith has made you well. Jesus was going to Jerusalem. And this is interesting, something you probably missed as I was reading this text. Jesus was going to Jerusalem, and this journey to Jerusalem would be the last trip Jesus would make before he suffers and dies on the cross. Notice how Jesus had no hesitation, but more importantly, notice there could have been hundreds of ways Jesus could have went to Jerusalem, but Jesus chose this route. The route, according to our text today, was the route that bordered Samaria and Galilee. Jesus knew exactly what this route would do. This route that he chose would bring him into a village where there would be 10 hopeless, helpless people struggling with an incurable disease, waiting to die a very early death, a very painful death. Jesus knew that he was going to be coming right through their village, running into all 10 of these men with leprosy. And what happens? They cried out to him. Because people with leprosy were considered incurable. Leprosy is a form of a skin disease where you get lumps and sores and open sores and bruises. It seeps, it drains, and it's more unbelievably painful than you can ever imagine. The deformities come at a high rate because you scratch and you itch at your skin, and it literally eats your bones and flesh from the inside out. You start to lose fingers and toes. Even your nose and your ears start to disappear. They wrap themselves, their head up with bandage. They wrap their hands up with bandages because they don't want anyone to see their hideousness from the outside. People with leprosy were considered unclean, and so they would stand many feet away from a person, and as someone would be walking up to them, not noticing that they're lepers, they were commanded to cry out, unclean, unclean, and if not, heavy consequences would come to the lepers who were not willing to say unclean. Some of the things that they missed most were the community and the Jewish ceremonies of worship. Lepers could not go near any Jewish worship ceremonies. You know, one of the things the Lord showed me is when you take something away from someone, they miss it more than ever. When someone's got something free willy-nilly, you can go, you can come, you can do as you please. Then all of a sudden, you start not really taking, or you start taking church for granted, and you start really not caring about what God has for you in a church service. But there's a reason why the Word of God declares that we are not to forsake the weekly fellowship of gathering together, because you notice at the beginning of the service, we allowed people to confess their sin. I just want to help you to understand, it was the born-again believers confessing their sin. There are some people sitting in this worship service that think, well, I hope I'm good to go. I'm not sure I'm good to go. And there are some that know, I know I'm not good to go. And for those people, the service is bringing them to the cross to help them for the first time do what the rest of us did at the beginning of the service, which is to confess our sins, trust Christ, look to God, and be brought back into a living, personal, trusting relationship, because we tend to veer. So for the first-timers, they are brought to Christ and saved. And for those of us that come on a weekly basis, we love to be in the presence of God. Why is it so important? Because if we just sit and listen online, my friends, you miss something. Yes, the Holy Spirit can touch you when you listen online, but when you're in the presence of God with his people, the Spirit of God is moving. And you can't reproduce that in front of a TV screen. Amen? You need to start telling your friends, church isn't sitting at home in front of a computer screen. Church is getting up and getting to a church. And I don't care where you're at. I don't care what part of the world you live in. I know I got people that watch me all over the world. I get messages and people watching the service. I'm glad you're watching, but get yourself into a church as well. You can listen to a good worship service online. You can go and you can be part of what God is doing. Find a Bible-believing church that believes in the inerrant and infallible Word of God. Get into a church that's not afraid to pray over someone that's sick and believe that miracles can happen and God can heal now on the spot. Trust that God, His Word, can bring people to a personal salvation and be willing and able to be part of what God is doing in a good, godly church. You see, God was healing lepers. He was moving, and the 10 lepers in our text that were standing at a distance purposely were isolating themselves. And in verse 13, they were calling out in a loud voice, Jesus, have mercy upon us. And in my first point, we see that Jesus has ears, and his ears are open to our cries for mercy. Their petition was a prayer of faith. That's how Luther saw it. He saw them as they cried out that it was almost like a petition of a prayer of faith. More than likely, these lepers had heard about Jesus. All they knew is that he was a man who preached hope, and they wanted to be a part of what God was doing because people's lives are being changed. And these were a people who had no hope. And so, thanks be to God, rumor had it that Jesus is coming. Can you imagine? They're sitting, standing outside the city gates, and up over the hill comes Jesus and his disciples, and they're walking towards him, and they say, could it be? Could that be the one? That one that's coming towards us? Do you think it could be him, Jesus? Have you been so broken and desperate in your sin? Has life been so hard on you that you're that hungry for Jesus to come over the hill and come towards you? Because, my friend, if God's brought you into his worship service today, Christ is coming for you. Amen? God wants to do business with you. He wants to deal with you. And so what do they do? They cry out to him. And he lets us cry out to him in this worship service as he is active and present. The body of God, you, his body, assembles. And he is present when the word is read and he starts to move in miraculous and unbelievable ways. Obviously, they believed that Jesus had the power to heal them. And they made no demands on Jesus. They just came crying out to him merely in as an appeal for mercy and compassion, because they were so hopeless and helpless that they knew that they were unworthy and undeserving, but hopefully God have mercy on us. And they set the example for us as we come into church every single Sunday. When we come in with a humble attitude and a humble spirit, that we are going to be brought before the living God, that we are going to hear his word preached, and they are going to give us the example of how we see Jesus as the promised Messiah, as we see Jesus as the Son of God, the one who came to earth to fulfill the divine prophecy. You say, well, what divine prophecy are you talking about, Pastor Sean? Well, today marks the beginning of a 5-week church calendar year called Advent. Advent, kids, is Christmas. It's Jesus coming to earth and giving us the hope that we could have something beyond anything that we can measure up in ourselves. This is God who sent his son in the form of a baby produced in the womb of a woman who was trying to live her life out in Christ. This woman, Mary, she brings Jesus into the world. And we know that he lived his life a perfect man in order to become the fulfillment of the law of God on our behalf through his death and resurrection on the cross. He made the complete atonement. In other words, he made all the work necessary so that he could be the propitiation or the sacrifice. He could be the acceptable thing given to God on our behalf. And in order for that to happen, God had to separate himself. We're going to talk about that in a little bit. But he had to do it all alone so that you and I had a journey away to heaven. Amen. This is the work of God on our behalf. The death and resurrection makes a complete atonement for the sins of the whole world, not just for a few that are good in the world, not for just a few of the elect. No, no, no. He does it for the whole world. Do I believe in a universalism? No, I believe that he forgave the sins of the whole world so that when you hear the word of God, you can confess and receive and believe and become part of the narrow gate. The narrow gate which trusts and walks in the righteousness of grace, because now you are born from above, born again. And God has brought you into that deliverance. And we know that he was delivered from death. He delivers us from death, our own death, the second death. He delivers us from our sins and he rises to new life. And when we are brought to new life, this is called justification. He is seated back with the Trinity and he sends his Holy Spirit down to work on us. And him's coming back through his word to us is called justification. In Romans 4:25, we see a beautiful picture of how he was delivered to death for our sins, raised to new life for your and my justification. Now we know that he even now sits at the right hand of God. And what is he doing? He's praying and interceding for us. In Romans chapter 8, verse 34, it says, Who is he that condemns? Christ Jesus, who died. More than that, who was raised to life, is at the right hand of God and is interceding for those that condemn. So who are those that condemn? There are three major entities. The devil is one. The world is the other one. And this is the tough one. The very thing that you love most and I love most, your flesh and my flesh. The war that we fight against is what we look at in the picture, in the mirror every single day. And we fall in love with me, myself, and I. And the question starts out in Romans 8:34, who is he that condemns? And when the devil comes knocking, the world comes knocking, and when our own flesh starts to bring conviction of the things that we've said and done, Jesus is busy interceding for you. 1 John 2:1 says this, my dear children, I write this to you so that you will not sin, but anyone who does sin, we have one who speaks to the Father in our defense, Jesus, the righteous one. We know that he who overcomes will not only overcome, but we will be given to him and he will never drive us away. Take a look at that passage in John 6:37. And all that the Father gives me will come to me, and whoever comes to me, I will never drive away. What a beautiful picture. John 6:37 helps us to know that we are, that he has the power to forgive, that he has the power to take away our troubles. He has the power to do all of the things that he promises to do as we are brought to him. Who brings us? The Father brings us. He draws us. He puts faith into us. We respond by either going to Christ or rejecting Christ. And my dear friends, there will be a broad latitude of people on the day of judgment. And those that were given faith, and all those who hear the word of God are given faith and responded and trusted in Christ, they'll be washed and cleansed and entered into their eternal home and glory. But those that were given the Holy Spirit and the faith and the word of God, just like this crew over here, but said, no, thank you, I'd rather follow my flesh, I'd rather follow the world, and I'd rather follow the lies of the devil, and I'd like to just dip my toe in the promises of God and pretend that I'm a Christian, but I'm really not a Christian because I've never had fruit of a true born-again follower of Jesus, so I am really kind of just a pretender. That crowd, and the Bible says, broad is the road which most people will go. Broad is the road which most people will go that are playing the game. And narrow is the gate which only a few people will go that will be in eternal glory. And Jesus has come to show us the picture through the one that returned to him with grateful arms. How did he return to him? Well, he returned to him because of those mighty hands willing to help, which brings me to point two. His hands are strong and they help. Mark chapter 1, verse 41 talks about the picture. He says, filled with compassion, he reached out his hand, and what did he do? He touched the man. His hands are strong, and the Bible says that he saw them, and he said, go. It's an imperative command. Go and show yourself to the priest. And as they went, it said they were cleansed. They were not cleansed when he said go. They took off running, and as they were running, the scales started falling from their arms, and their skin started growing back, and the sores started disappearing. And as they ran closer and closer, and I'm going to think they probably weren't walking, but they were running with joy in their heart, knowing that I'm going to be healed. And as they ran, they were cleansed. And others might have walked by that group of 10 people and just ignored them as they walked by. But not Jesus. Jesus saw what a sorry mess they were. Jesus saw that they were in need of a touch from him, and he was fully aware of their miserable condition. He also saw their faith and they put their faith in him when Jesus was speaking. Faith was created deeper and deeper. They were hopeless and helpless. They went to Christ. They cried out. Christ started speaking his word into them. More faith was created, and they leaned into him. And he put them to the test by telling them to go to the priest. Let me ask you a question today. Is your faith being put to the test this month? Has it been a hard week, hard month, hard year? Do you call upon the name of Jesus, but you're wondering where he is and why he's not there? Are you wondering why he's not been willing to help you through some of the things you're struggling with? Well, my friend, I want to share with you that there's a parallel between the dread disease of leprosy and the dread disease of sin. And the difference is between the manner of leprosy, which ostracized its victims from all of the Christian or the Jewish community, and the manner in which sin severs us from God and from God's people. You see, when you're living in sin, you don't want to fellowship with God's people. You don't want to go to Bible study. You don't want to do devotionals. You don't want to surrender. You don't want to put your flesh under the hearing of God's word and stop looking at pornography and stop cheating with your eyes and lusting after some woman in the workplace or dreaming of some guy that would rather be a better husband than the man you're married to. Or you don't want to stop with your gossiping lips and putting the worst construction and looking for little ways that you can find things in people that are doing things wrong. No, you'd rather go and play on the edge of hell and never confess it and pretend that you're good than to come clean and say, God, have mercy on me, like these lepers beating their chest, crying out to him. You see, Jesus saw them and he had compassion on them. And that compassion produced three gospel things in that imperative command. And I want you to take note, confirmation clue students, get your pens out and start writing. Number one, the gospel imperative command produced, number one, the instructions for the lepers to go to the priest. And what was going on? Well, Jesus talks as if the miracle had already occurred. He takes the healing for granted, not in a bad way, but he's talking like, yeah, you've already been healed. But they're looking at themselves and they're saying, no, we haven't. But Jesus is speaking like, yes, you have. And what do they do? It causes them to take off bolting for the priest. Reminds me of Isaiah 65:24 that says, before they call, I will answer. While they are speaking, I've already heard them. This is a God who knows your thoughts, who knows your hearts, and always is there with you. This is a God who calls us. He brings us into faith. Starting at the waters, he brings us into faith. At the communion table, in the body and the blood, he brings us into faith. When I'm preaching the word and declaring the love of God, he brings us into faith. And what are we doing? We're believing we're forgiven when we cry out to God. And where is the goal? Where's the priest we're running towards? Well, it's not a priest here on earth. It's a priest in heaven called Jesus, and our focus is home, not this earth. Our focus is Christ, and we're running towards him. Amen. That's where we're running towards, believing that whatever we're suffering with, whatever we're sick with, that God is going to heal us, as we keep reminding ourselves of the promise that lives in us and got us, who spoke faith into us. And point two, the gospel flowing from this imperative command of Jesus is his directive requires faith by all 10 lepers. For them to have asked for healing and then to have been told to go to the priest, they take off running. that by the time they arrived, their miracle would have occurred. Ultimately, what God is showing them, without them even comprehending what he's doing, is he's showing them, you just walk in blind faith and God will do the verb. God will do the thing that our flesh is always trying to do for us. Oh, if I just do this better. Oh, God will be happy with this. If I could just start praying 12 hours instead of 2 minutes or 1 30-second prayer. If I could just get with it more and more. God says, just take off. Ultimately, God is doing the verb, and the author of faith who gives such faith, which is Jesus, Ephesians chapter 2, verse 8 and 9 says that it is by grace you've been saved through faith, not from yourselves. It is a gift of God, not by works so that no one can boast. And then 3, this is big. Jesus conforms to the law of Moses because he knew that the lepers were concerned. They wanted to be welcomed back, and the only way for them to be welcomed back was through the priest. And so Jesus conforms to the laws of Moses. He tells them to go to the priest. They come back. And Jesus followed the rules of God for us. And he set them free to follow the laws and rules of Moses so that they could be free. And he sets you free. In fact, those that are truly free in Christ find it a joy to live in submission to the rules instead of kicking against the goads and wanting to do everything to fight against the rules. Point 3. Jesus, our divine healer, his act deserves our gratitude, verses 15 through 19. On one occasion, Jesus touched the leper in Mark 1:41. We talked about that a little earlier. I want you to think of Jesus' compassion as he takes upon himself the leprosy of sin. At the cross where he became sin for all of mankind, in 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 21, it said, God made him to be sin who was no sin, so that in him we might become the righteousness of God. He bore all of our iniquities. He bore all of our sins. He bore all of our mistakes, just like society had to stand away from the lepers and not go near the lepers. So God the Father in Matthew 27:46 had to literally stand away from Jesus when he cried out, my God, why have you forsaken me? God put a gulf between the Father and the Son. The dreaded innocence of Jesus had to face all of the sins that you and I have ever committed, the sins of all of mankind, were dropped onto Jesus, and God had nothing to do with him so he could be the full and complete sacrifice. God had to separate so that when Jesus rose from the dead and joined God in heaven again, that sacrifice done outside of the Trinity would be an acceptable sacrifice because the Trinity can have nothing to do with sin. Jesus literally bore your sin and my sin, and the Father, compelled by his own holiness, had to distance himself from the Son. This was all done so that Jesus could make a way to draw us by the Holy Spirit into heaven through the perfect work that he lived and worked out here on earth. And by the power of the Holy Spirit, when God touches you, how do you respond? When the Holy Ghost comes upon you and he gives you faith and he trusts you, what do you do? Well, I want us to look at one leper who responded the right way. One leper who got it. One leper who turned back to the one who spoke faith and gave him everything. And when he got back to Jesus, he fell on his knees and he cried out to Jesus. He confessed his belief in Jesus, and through thanksgiving and praise, he showed Jesus that he had received the grace of God, which had got him, set him free, and give him the hope. You see, this leper not only believed that he was healed and received by Christ, but by his actions, we read that he believed in the one who healed him. My dear friends, if you've been struggling, if you've been hurting, if you've been coming back to church week after week reading the Word of God, you're running just like those lepers. You're running to the priest, the great high priest, and you're trusting that the promise is going to completely cleanse you and set you free. And I'm telling you today, if you run with the thanksgiving of what God has done for you through his death and resurrection, this healing that he proclaims for you is a healing that is done now. It's going to happen as you run. Keep your eyes on the cross. Keep believing believing in Christ. Keep confession and affirmation on your lips and say, I believe in Jesus. I trust that he's going to heal me. And as God's words keep speaking to you, receive the healing now. Just say, God, I need this and I receive it. I want your healing. I'm hungry for a healing. Whatever your emotional try is, maybe it's a physical thing. God can heal physical things. He can deal with emotional and traumatic things. Whatever your hurt is, whatever the separation has been, just receive God's declaration and be healed. That's what the leper shows us to do as we respond to God. Let us stand and respond now with a grateful heart. Amen.
Yours is the victory.
Let's lift up a shout of praise to him.
Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. If you've been here today and you've been just hearing God's word and you need prayer, you need a touch from God, then I want you to know that we're going to pray for you. We're going to give a benediction here, but I'm going to have, maybe I'll have Kevin and Greg, my prayer warrior, they can be down here, and anybody else and any man cave guys want to be praying. If you come down, you're going to get prayed over. Because when God puts a burden on your spirit to not do anything with that burden, it becomes a heavy rock that pulls you under. And when there's revelation that there's something that needs to be dealt with, the scriptures declare, deal with it right now. So the Holy Spirit could have been dealing with you as I was preaching and he was working through whatever I was saying. Get things right with God. Amen. So I'm going to give a benediction and we'll have some prayer people right up here to pray as people are leaving. Just come and get prayed for if you need prayer. I want you to hear the grace and love of God as the Holy Spirit's been working in your hearts today. The Bible says in 2 Corinthians 13:14, that it is his grace, the grace of the Savior. And it is his love, the love of God, that has brought us together under the fellowship of the Holy Spirit. And in that fellowship, Romans 15:13 says that there's a hope that's been produced through the preaching of his word today. And this hope will fill you from head to toe with a joy that's overflowing, and it is a peace, and it is a trust. And it says, so that you may overflow with the hope of the power of the Holy Ghost. Just say, God, fill me to overflowing with the power of the Holy Ghost as I go out into the world and tell them what you've done for me. And so may the peace of God and the love of God fill you to overflowing. In the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, go in peace and serve the Lord. If you need prayer, come on down. I'm going to have Kevin and Greg come on down and meet some people. Go in peace and serve the Lord.
Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise him, all creatures here below. Praise him above the heavenly host. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost.
So good to worship you today, church. Be blessed. Enjoy this beautiful Sunday, and we will see you next Sunday. God bless you all.